Okay, here we're going to be talking about overturning forces. Every shear wall must resist overturning forces. And if overturning forces are not resisted, it can often result in the most serious catastrophic damage. Many of the homes in the Marina District that were destroyed, they suffered from overturning forces applied to the walls that were supporting the house. Now, overturning forces act much as if you were to take a chest of drawers and push on the top of it, trying to scoot it across the room, and it tips over. There are many ways to address overturning forces, which primarily cause damage when you have living area above a garage. One, you can use an engineering principle called principal rotation. The other method is to use what's called a moment column or cantilevered column. And at the back of this video, last couple of slides, you'll see what they look like and how to install them. So anyway, in this next video, please study this very carefully so that you understand how overturning forces work. It's often misunderstood. Many engineers, many contractors do not take this into consideration, and it's a very, very serious matter in your shear wall design. Imagine if there had been a living area above this garage. Imagine it's rocking back and forth, left to right, and what it would have happened. In such a case, the garage could easily have collapsed, causing catastrophic damage to the living area above. You can see the garage doors on either side of this building's entranceway. The floor above the entranceway rocked back and forth to the left and to the right and was in danger of collapse before the earthquake stopped. Here you can see how very narrow walls on either side of the garage door opening collapsed. This was in the Santa Cruz Hills in the 1989 earthquake. In the upper photograph, we see a home with a living area above a garage. On either side of the garage door opening, we have narrow walls that can tip over in an earthquake because of overturning forces. If these walls tip over, the sort of damage we see in the lower photograph can occur. One of the ways of dealing with this problem is with the moment frame. A moment frame is a very large steel frame embedded in concrete that resists all the earthquake forces as the floor above the garage door opening rocks back and forth. In very simple terms, as the earthquake force pushes against the floor of the house, the shear wall that is attached to that floor will want to overturn, as shown by the red arrow. If the shear wall starts to overturn, you can see at the bottom of the shear wall is being lifted up off the foundation, and as it begins to fail, the cripple wall studs begin to lean. Here's a close-up of the kind of damage I'm talking about. As soon as the plywood tears up off of the mud sill, the plywood is no longer attached to the bolts, which are required to transfer earthquake forces down into the foundation. At this point, the effectiveness of this shear wall has been severely compromised. If the bottom edge of this plywood had been nailed into blocks, as discussed in part 3, the blocks would be lifted up off of the mud sill and the nails unable to transfer these earthquake forces into the mud sill and into the ground. This is another reason why nailed blocks or stapled blocks should be avoided in shear walls whenever possible. Overturning forces are resisted by something that's put on either end of the shear wall that are called hold downs or tie downs. Here's a shear wall that is being built before the plywood is installed. So you can see the bolts, which should be spaced approximately 2 feet apart, and on each side, the shiny pieces of the hardware are the hold downs. So imagine we have our plywood nailed to all of these 2x4s. On the left-hand side
where the new 2x4s are. When our shear wall tries to overturn, it will pull up on those new 2x4s. The new 2x4s, in turn, are bolted to our hold down. So then, our hold down will try to pull up off the foundation. Now the hold down is attached to the foundation with the long bolt that is epoxied to the concrete. So now what happens, it pulls up on the foundation, and the weight of the foundation prevents the shear wall from turning over. Here's an illustration of how hold downs work. As the earthquake force pushes against the top of our shear wall, the shear wall tries to overturn. When it tries to overturn, it pulls up on the hold down. The hold down in turn pulls up on the bolt, which is epoxied very deep into the concrete. This in turn pulls up on the concrete itself, which is very heavy. The weight of the concrete keeps the shear wall from overturning. Here we have a case where the earthquake force is so strong, or the concrete is so weak, that the concrete actually breaks. When this happens, the shear wall remains attached to the concrete and simply rocks back and forth with the concrete. This diagram illustrates why overturning forces occur. 3,600 pounds of earthquake force are being pushed to the right along the top of the wall. This wall is 12 feet long. Therefore, each linear foot of wall must resist 300 pounds per foot. This also occurs at the base of the shear wall, where the foundation is. This force is resisted by the foundation bolts. Notice how the left side of the wall is being pushed up with something called the overturning force. And on the right side of the wall, notice that the shear wall is pushing down on the foundation with something called compression force. These two forces working together try and flip the shear wall over or overturn it. Just as the top of the shear wall is resisting 300 pounds per linear foot of shear wall, so do the two sides do the same thing. So the left side is 8 feet tall, so it must resist 8 times 300 pounds per linear foot, or 2,400 pounds. And the same is the case on the right side of the wall. If these overturning forces are not resisted, it can cause a great deal of damage to the shear wall and render it ineffective. Here we're going to be looking at some photographs of homes that were damaged in the 1989 earthquake in San Francisco, California. Damage like this occurred when the narrow walls on either side of the garage door opening collapsed, causing the building to fall, say, 8 feet onto the ground. One way of addressing the weakness caused by a living area above a garage is the installation of what's called the cantilevered column. A cantilevered column is embedded in concrete at its base, which includes a lot of rebar, and at the top it is attached to the floor. This cantilevered column is very stiff, very rigid, very strong, and when the floor tries to move to the left, it's resisted by this column, and when it tries to move to the right, it's also resisted by this column. This is a photograph of the concrete that the cantilevered column is embedded in. It extends from one end of the garage to the other. The amount of concrete and the amount of rebar in this concrete must be determined by a structural engineer. So here's a photograph of the rebar that's been placed inside the trench of concrete that is attached to our cantilever column. Notice the sledgehammer on the right with the orange head. This gives you some sort of perspective on how large the column is and how deep the foundation is.
So hopefully you understand how overturning forces work, and I'd like to just point something out of interest. You can actually build a new shear wall according to the modern building code. That's a 2010 California building code. It's 4 feet wide and 10 feet tall and not install hold down. This is an oversight, in my opinion, in the code, and I recommend that you do not do this. When you build a shear wall, you can build it to code without resisting overturning forces, but I think you're doing that at your own peril. Please, it's very important for you to see why overturning forces are critical to resist. If you do not resist these forces, your shear wall can be destroyed and a great deal of damage can occur, possibly catastrophic.